right, so if you recall, we have been in a series through the Beatitudes, and today we're going to finish up the Beatitudes. We're going to talk about the last Beatitude in Matthew chapter 5. Now, we've talked about it in a particular perspective, and the idea is that Jesus is telling us something that is complete opposite to what the world is trying to tell us. It's the complete opposite, so we could call it an upside-down kingdom. That the kingdom of God, we talked about it a little bit today in Sunday school, it's an alternate city, it's an alternate kingdom, it's an alternative to what the world offers us. And the very first one just is a classic example. Well, the world tells you that the best way for you to be happy in life is to think that you're great and you're awesome. And then along comes Jesus saying, blessed are those who are poor in spirit, or those who admit that they're not awesome and that God is awesome. Those people are the happiest, the ones that recognize their limitations, their bankruptcy spiritually, and then recognize that God has given them everything that pertains to life and godliness. That our faith in Him, everything about us that's good, is a direct gift from His grace and His goodness. Now, I'm not going to rehash every single one of these, and everybody says, amen. But I wanted to give you an example. And we come to the last one today in Matthew chapter 5 in verses 10 through 12. Matthew chapter 5, verses 10 through 12. They're kind of the same. They look like they're different Beatitudes, but they're kind of lumped together. So we want to cover them completely. So let's turn to Matthew chapter 5, starting in verse 10. Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when others revile you and persecute you and utter all kinds of evil against you falsely on my account. Rejoice and be glad, for your reward is great in heaven. For so they persecuted the prophets who were before you. Now, that is pretty stark contrast to what the world would tell us, I would think. The world would tell us that we need to follow the majority. They tell us that because a majority of the world thinks a certain way, that therefore we should think a certain way. We should think the same way they do and have a collective mindset. This idea that we all think and feel the same way. And Jesus is saying, blessed are those who are persecuted. Well, why would you be persecuted? Because you think and say different things. You believe different things than the rest of the world. So what I want to do today is I want to paint a picture for you of what is happening in our society. And then we want to come back to a few more passages. So when I look out across the world, primarily, we're going to look primarily in the United States today, and we're going to look at some cases in the Midwest, just in some neighboring states, on where I think persecution is coming from. I want to look at what's happening in our world that shows us that Jesus was right, that persecution is going to come. Now, we thankfully right now do not have to worry about what's happening, say, in China, in the Middle East, where they're torturing and killing Christians for fun. Thank God we live in a country that we don't have to worry about that, amen? That we live in one of the most free countries in the world that allows us to worship God in a way that we see fit. But that may or may not be the case forever. So I want to look at a couple. We're going to experience persecution from what I would call the mob, the culture around us that seems to pile on anyone who says anything that they disagree with. We have what's called cancel culture. And any time right now, at any given moment, they're all over the place. Any time a celebrity or any politician says anything that the mob deems inappropriate or wrong, Twitter blows up. Like, literally, they almost shut down the Twitter servers because there are people that just pile on, calling them racist, misogynist, sexist, call them whatever they want. They are constantly piling on people and destroying careers and destroying people's lives because they dared to say something different than what they believed. It's called the cancel culture. They do this all the time. There are TV hosts that are no longer on TV hosts because are on TV because of this very thing. There are people who have been in the show business for a long time that no longer have careers because the world just jumps on top of them. And it's even worse for Christians. It's even worse for Christians. Trust me, if you go out into your world, into your society, and you say some of the things that the Bible says, trust me, they will shout you down. They will make sure to do everything they can to shut you up constantly. In fact, there are places all around the world, all around our country right now, where to take a biblical view of marriage is considered hate speech. Which means that if you take that biblical view of marriage, that means that they can arrest you and throw you in jail in certain circumstances because it is hate speech. You are saying something that offends somebody else to the point where they can arrest you and throw you in jail. That is not the case here right now, but there are places in our country where that's true. We're going to receive constant persecution from the law. Let me give you a couple of examples. In California, there is a bill called AB 2943. And what it does is it makes it so that they can financially go after institutions and people who sell material goods like books that might say something that goes against a particular sexual ethic in the church or in the world. If you say something that they deem inappropriate about, say, sexuality or gender, and it's in a book, they can fine you and then remove the sale of that book from California. So there are schools like Biola University, which is a Christian university, that are having serious conversations about right now about whether they're going to be able to continue in that state, because all of the books that they have and use as textbooks would be considered financially punitive. But it's not just California. If you've looked, I don't know, does anyone follow our presidential election cycles? I try not to, but sometimes it's hard to avoid that. They had a town hall meeting where they were interviewing different candidates, and one candidate was asked if churches that do not agree with and affirm same-sex marriage, if they should lose their 501c3 status. This is just a couple of weeks ago. And without missing a beat, didn't even think about it, this person says, yes, they should. So, as a church, I want us to be prepared and to think about how much are we in love with our tax-exempt status. Because it is not too much to think that in the near future that could be gone if we're going to stand on biblical values and core principles. Like a year, not 15. Like it's not that far away. That's another example. In Toronto, Canada, there's a man by the name of Jordan Peterson who was pretty much asked to leave his prominent teaching position at Toronto University because he refused to refer to people by their preferred gender pronouns. He has something to the effect of 300 and 400 students, and he was asked to make sure and remember which one of the 70 pronouns they prefer. And he actually went to the government and said, you can't do this. This is a violation of my free speech. And they said, no, it's not. And he said, no, you're actually compelling me to say something. That right down the road, they are forcing people to say things that they don't believe. Otherwise, you will receive a loss of job, loss of character, loss of faith in the community over and over and over again. In 2016, let's bring it a little closer to home. In 2016, there was a lawsuit by a church in Iowa that they had to sue the government of Iowa because the Civil Rights Commission in Iowa read the civil rights laws and decided that they could force churches in Iowa to obey the gender issues when it comes to bathrooms in the church. They could force churches to allow men who identify as women and women who identify as men to go into the bathrooms of the opposite sex because of the way the law was written. This was in Iowa. Constantly, the law is going to be consistently persecuting the church. And these are light things compared to what could be coming down the road. These are what we call stepping stones. It's not like they're going to stop there. It starts here. We are constantly going to be bombarded by what we call academia. The college universities are constantly just throwing rhetoric out. Going back to Iowa again, just this year, at the University of Iowa, there was a religious student organization that was barred from being on campus because they forced or they asked their leaders to sign a pledge of things that they believe. And they viewed that as discrimination and told them they could no longer operate on the school campus. That was February of this year. Now, fortunately, they actually took that to court and the judge ruled in the favor of their organization, but this is constantly going on, even right here in the Midwest. I used to think, well, this stuff's not going to come here. It's just all over it's on the bookends, right? It's on the East and West Coast. It's not here. But no, it's happening right here, right now in the academia. Here's another person. If you follow any sort of person that what we would call the new atheist today, there's a guy by the name of Richard Dawkins. Richard Dawkins is a very famous author and a very famous biologist over in the UK, but a lot of atheists like to follow this guy because he's very virulent towards Christianity, and here's what he said. This is a quote direct from Richard Dawkins. It is fashionable to wax apocalyptic about the threat to humanity posed by the AIDS virus, mad cow disease, and many others. And here's a kicker. But I think a case can be made that faith is one of the world's great evils, comparable to the smallpox virus, but harder to eradicate. This is a prominent professor at Oxford University saying that we need to eradicate faith in Christianity. We need to eradicate it, like we do viruses and smallpox. It's a disease on the earth. This is the constant view coming from the world right now. We see it in entertainment. And where the most egregious ones are happening, the ones that are the most heinous, is we see it in the church. Over and over and over again, we see people coming out saying that they are no longer Christians because of this view or of that view of the church, and trying to shame the church into taking a view that Jesus said is not acceptable. Trying to shame us into it over and over and over again. This is happening right in the church. It's not just, so face it, you will get sometimes persecution from the church. You can't hide from it within these four walls. It could happen right in here. Persecution happens. Now, that sounds awful, doesn't it? That sounds absolutely terrible. Now, let me read again what Jesus said in verse 12 of Matthew chapter 5. Rejoice and be glad, for your reward is great in heaven, for so they persecuted the prophets who were before you. Jesus has a completely different understanding of persecution than we do. And I want to lift this up and to think more highly about this, because I told people before church started, I said, I'm going to paint this picture and we'll be able to look across the church and we're going to see people shaking heads on how awful this is and how terrible this is. And I was correct. I looked across the congregation. There are people going, oh my gosh, this world's going to hell in a handbasket. And everyone was thinking that. And Jesus said, no, it's the exact opposite. Blessed are you when you are persecuted for my name's sake. You know what the word blessed means? Happy. You should be happy when the world persecutes you for my name's sake, for yours will be the kingdom of heaven. If there is one surefire way to know that God, that you are in the part of the kingdom of God, is to stand firm on your principles when facing persecution and to know that the kingdom belongs to you. Happy are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake. Blessed are those are you when others revile you and persecute you, and here's the kicker, utter all kinds of evil against you falsely on my account. This is a good thing. Okay, let's just breathe for a minute. Persecution is a good thing. Do you know when the church grew the most in the Bible? When they were forced to spread from Jerusalem because persecution was great. Every time. Then when Emperor Nero comes along and he's persecuting Christians, all of a sudden they're up into England and all the other parts of the world. Every time persecution comes, that's when the church grows the most. You know how I know? Because it's happening today. You know where the persecution is the greatest right now? China. Do you know what the fastest growing church in the world is right now? China. The next is Iran. The second fastest growing church in the world is in Iran, where it is criminal to even utter the name of Jesus almost. And they're the fastest growing church in the world, hiding and meeting in each other's houses under the guise of something else, always loving the Lord and seeking the Lord. Persecution is good because the church grows under persecution. I want to look at a couple of other passages that we should think about. 1 Peter chapter 4, starting in verse 12. Peter wrote a lot about persecution, especially in 2 Peter, but in 1 Peter he says this: Beloved, do not be surprised at the fiery trial when it comes upon you to test you, as though some strange thing were happening to you. First of all, let's stop there for a sec. Don't be surprised. It is amazing to me how many Christians, when someone comes against them, goes, I don't know what I'm going to do. Why did this happen to me? What's happening? Jesus said from the beginning, they hated me, they're going to hate you. Just the way it is. It shouldn't surprise us at all. And he says, it has come upon you to test you. It is part of God's plan to reveal your own shortcomings and your own things you need to work on to you. But rejoice insofar as you share Christ's sufferings, that you may also rejoice and be glad when his glory is revealed. If you are insulted for the name of Christ, you are blessed because the Spirit of glory and of God rests upon you. But let none of you suffer as a murderer or a thief or an evildoer or as a meddler. It's kind of funny that meddlers are right in there with thieves and murderers, but we'll just leave that one alone. Yet if anyone suffers as a Christian, let him not be ashamed, but let him glorify God in that name, for it is time for judgment to begin at the household of God. And if it begins with us, what will be the outcome for those who do not obey the gospel of God? And if the righteous is scarcely saved, what will become of the ungodly and the sinner? Therefore, let those who suffer according to God's will entrust their souls to a faithful Creator while doing good. I want to look at a couple of things in there. First of all, we talked about the surprise one. But we also need to look at the idea that if you see this shift between verse 15 and verse 16. Verse 15 says, let none of you suffer as a murderer or a thief or as an evildoer or as a meddler. Yet if anyone suffers as a Christian. What he's saying is, if you suffer as a Christian, that means you are not a meddler or a murderer or a thief or all those things. He's drawing a clear distinction. If you find yourself being a murderer, which I hope we don't have any of those in here, I'm willing to counsel you, but I may need to have some armed security guard in the process. But if you're a thief or murderer and a meddler, someone likes to get involved in somebody else's business and meddle and cause division and dissension, he's drawing the distinction between that and suffering as a Christian. And what he's saying is, anyone know this? I've seen many people that do this. They will sit there and they will be suffering because of some poor decision they made. And they'll say, man, God is really allowing persecution in my life. No, he's allowing the physical consequences of a bad decision in your life. That is not persecution. Persecution is when they revile you for Christ's sake, for the name of Jesus, because you stand up for Christian values. That is persecution. And if you suffer as a Christian, don't be ashamed, but glorify God. That's what he's saying. Don't be ashamed, because what happens a lot now is when Christians are persecuted, primarily in the West, they seem to figure it out in China, is when persecution starts to come, they start to shrink back. Well, I didn't mean it that way. You took my comments out of context, and we shrink back. He said, don't be ashamed, Apostle Paul said, I'm not ashamed of the gospel. I'm not ashamed of that. Instead, look, I will take your reviling, I will take your shame, and I will glorify God in the process and say that he is the ruler over all things, and what he said is far more important than your opinions. Far more important than your opinions. Let's look at another passage. I'm going to scare the liver out of you. We're going to read the entire chapter of 2 Timothy 3. The whole chapter. Now, granted, it's only like 17 verses, but still. 2 Timothy 3 says, but understand this, that in the last days there will come times of difficulty. He's talking about in the church, by the way. This is not in the world. This is from the church. Remember when I said persecution can come from the church? For people will be lovers of self, lovers of money, proud, arrogant, abusive, and here's one of those weird ones again, disobedient to their parents, ungrateful, unholy, heartless, unappeasable, slanderous, without self-control, brutal, not loving good, treacherous, reckless, swollen with conceit, lovers of pleasure rather than lovers of God. And here it is, having the appearance of godliness, but deny its power. Avoid such people, for among them are those who creep into households and capture weak women, burdened with sins and led astray by various passions, always learning and never able to arrive at a knowledge of the truth. Let's stop there for a second. There's this ongoing thing right now where people, because they don't want to sound like arrogant or cocky, they'll sit there and say, well, my interpretation of this is this, but you might have a different one. At some point, the truth has to stand. And at some point, there are peripheral issues of the church that we can disagree on, but there are points of the gospel that we cannot waver on and we have to stand firm on. And the Bible is very clear here that we should avoid people who are always learning and never able to arrive at a knowledge of the truth. It said avoid them. There are things in the Bible that are black and white and true, and we should stand on them, and the only way to get around them is to do a bunch of mental gymnastics with the original Greek. But they're true, and they're right, and they're the Word of God, and we should stand on them. Okay, that's enough of my rant. Just as Jannes and Jambres opposed Moses, so these men also oppose the truth. Men corrupted in mind and disqualified regarding the faith, but they will not get very far, for their folly will be pain to all, as what that of those two men. You, however, have followed my teaching, my conduct, my aim in life, my faith, my patience, my love, my steadfast, my persecutions. This is Paul talking. Paul was beaten over and over and over again, stoned and left out to die. He was actually shipwrecked multiple times. I think he had three times he received the 39 lashes. And he says, you have observed and been a part of my persecutions and sufferings that happened to me at Antioch and Iconium and at Lystra, which persecutions I endured, yet from them all the Lord rescued me. Indeed, all who desire, here's the crazy verse. If you don't get anything else out of this message, listen to this verse. Indeed, all who desire to live a godly life in Christ Jesus will be persecuted. So show of hands, who desires to live a godly life in Jesus Christ? Praise Jesus. You're going to be persecuted. Period. No question mark, exclamation point. You will be persecuted, especially if you live that life out in public, which you should. You are going to suffer for Christ's sake. You're going to suffer for Jesus the way it is. All those who desire, and here's the kicker, it didn't say all those who actually live a godly life in Christ Jesus. It says those who desire to live a godly life. So even if you want to but don't always do it, you're going to suffer too. Okay, let's start back in verse. Indeed, all who desire to live a godly life in Christ Jesus will be persecuted. while evil people and imposters will go from bad to worse, deceiving and being deceived. But as for you, continue what you have learned and have firmly believed, knowing from whom you learned it, and how from childhood you have been acquainted with the sacred writings, which are able to make you wise for salvation through faith in Christ Jesus. All scripture is breathed out by God and profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction, and for training in righteousness, that the man of God may be complete, equipped for every good work. He said, stand firm in that. Stand up. And you notice what he said there? When you stand up, this is where he brought in the authenticity and the inerrancy of the scriptures of the Word of God. Saying, if you're going to stand on something, stand on what you know to be true in the scriptures. Stand on what you know to be true in the Bible, in the holy writings. Stand in those. They're right. They're true. They're good for correction and reproof. No one likes to think about those things, right? We want to talk about all the great things and wonderful things the Bible has for us. No, the Bible cuts us like a sword, able to pierce us and penetrate us. It is good for reproof and correction in our own lives as well. It's the Bible that we must lean on in places of persecution, not our own power, not our own will. I guarantee you, if you sit there and say that, you know what, I'm going to be really strong and powerful, and when the persecution comes, I'm going to stand there and be strong. No, you're not. It is your faithful study and devotion to the Word of God and your devotion to Him Himself. That's why we sang that song, Draw Me Close to You, You're All I Want. It is that desire, that will to, God, You're all I want. Anything I need, anything I desire, everything I want is in You and from You and for You. So therefore, I need You, because it is only in that that I can stand in my day of persecution. It is only in that that I can stand. Continue in what you have learned. There's one more point that I want to make. One more thing, and I want to go back to 1 Peter 4. And I kind of brushed over it when we read it the last time, but that last verse is haunting in verse 19. Therefore, let those who suffer according to God's will entrust their souls to a faithful Creator while doing good. Those who suffer according to God's will. Let me say it again. Those who suffer according to God's will. Let's just be very clear what he's saying there. It is the will of God that you suffer persecution. Nice, fun, happy message, Pastor. The will of God that we suffer persecution. And Jesus said, rejoice and be exceedingly glad. What would it be like? Oh man, I can see myself getting in trouble for that. What would it be like if we prayed that God would send trials our way? I'll never forget, there was a moment where I felt the Lord's hand on my life, that He was calling me to the ministry, and I went to my pastor, and I went to our church, and I asked that they would pray for me. And I will never forget the prayer that my own father prayed for me while I was seeking the Lord and going into the ministry. My father laid his hands on my head, and he said, God, it pains me to the point of tears. And my dad is weeping. It pains me to the point of tears, knowing that the only way for him to grow into the man that you need him to be is that you would send him through trials and fiery things and persecutions. And God, everything in my life as a father wants to protect him from those things. But God, I pray that you pour down the trials on this young man. That was my dad. Thanks a lot, Dad. You know what? It came true. I don't ask Dad to pray for very many things now, because I'm pretty sure he's got the voice of the Lord going on here. Because, man, it seemed like right after that, boom, bam, your life blows up because all you want to do is tell people about the loving grace of Jesus Christ, that they don't have to live a certain life anymore. Who are you to tell me I shouldn't live that life? I didn't say it. God said it. I don't believe in that. And over and over and over again, constantly. My dad started a church in a little town called Lake City, Iowa. A little town of 1,500 people. Blew my wife's mind the first time I took her to Lake City, and we just drove down the road, and I told her who lived in every single house right down the road. Could tell her who lived where. She's from Fort Dodge, which is like little Chicago, that's what we call it. Mostly because it's just as violent as Chicago, but that's why my wife's such a thug. But we started this church in Lake City, Iowa, the only real evangelical church within 30 or 40 miles of this place. And I will never forget it. One day, and I'm just starting to realize what God's doing in my life and what God's doing elsewhere, and I walk into the little gas station that's right there on the east side of town called Sparky's. And I walk in, and Sparky's has a row of tables, just like every gas station does, where all the people that like to talk about everybody else meet and to drink coffee, and then they talk about everybody else. I know it doesn't happen here, I'm sure of it, but it happens there. And I walked in with my dad, and no joke, it was loud and it was obnoxious. These guys are laughing and talking, all these things. The minute me and my dad walked in, silence, crickets. There's that cult church that actually meets in the basement. Do you know what made us a cult? We told people they should repent of their sins. So we're a cult. We told people that maybe if you're not married, you shouldn't live with someone you're not married to. We told people what we thought the Bible said, and that made us a cult. From people that were in churches every Sunday. And I began to get discouraged, and I began to get upset, and my dad looked at me and he said, "No, son, rejoice and be exceedingly glad, for ours is the kingdom of heaven." I want to reevaluate as a church, as a people of God, how we view what's happening in our country and our world. Do I think we should just fall down and think about and just let all these things, we should never speak up and just lay down and not say anything? No, I think we should stand boldly for the principles of the Word of God in a very public way. And what will happen is there will be some who hate us because they hate Jesus in us. And we can be like Peter. There's a wonderful story in the Bible that is amazing. Very first time Peter suffers any persecution, he gets beat and thrown in prison by Jewish people, his religious leaders. He gets beat and put in prison, and they escape miraculously, and Peter knocks on the door of this house where the people of God are meeting and praying for Peter. He knocks on the door, they open the door and they slam it in his face because there's no way it can be Peter because we're praying for Peter in here. So it can't be Peter. And Peter knocks again and he opens the door. And the Bible says that him and his companion rejoiced because they could share in the sufferings of Jesus Christ. It was wonderful joy to them to share in the sufferings of Christ. Like life wasn't complete until they could. Life, like they just didn't feel like they were doing what they could, what they should, until they got beat once. Anyone here feel that way? Boy, I really wish I lived my life till they beat me in the town square. I want to submit to you that the American church has a messed up view of persecution. And the fact that the church is telling you, this is not even the world, it's the world in the church, let's put it that way. The church is telling you and telling us that if we are suffering persecution in some way, we must be doing something wrong. God wants me to be healthy, wealthy, and wise. So therefore, if I'm being beat, I'm not healthy. So therefore, I must be doing something wrong. This is the problem with what we call the prosperity doctrine. Is a prosperity doctrine tells us that God wants you to be wealthy and full of health and wise all the time. But the problem is it doesn't square with the fact that the Bible says it's the will of God that I suffer. We need to redeem this idea and learn to expect persecution, to glorify God in persecution, and rejoice because we are more like Christ because of it. So yes, I pray that God, whatever it takes to make us more like you, do that. Whatever it takes. And that gets some people up in a bunch. If that means that we lose a few people in the process, I'm okay with that. If that means that there's little more conflict along the way, that we have to wrestle with things in the church, I'm okay with that. If that means that if I have to stand here, let's just take the 501c3 thing. This is a real thing for the church, and they're going to try and tell us that we have to stand in the pulpit and preach certain things that the Bible does not say. And if they don't, they won't let us deduct our tithes from our taxes anymore. We can't use the church as a tax shelter anymore. And as a man of God who is charged with preaching the Word of God, I will not preach that. And they can come and drag me off this pulpit and drag me to jail. I will not preach it. And it is up to the church to decide, what is the church going to do? Are we going to stand firm on biblical principles regardless of what they do to us? Or will we cave? I can't make that choice for you. But I have made that choice, and I have told the Lord that I am not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ, because it is the power of God unto salvation. Not what anyone tells me they think we should believe or should think, because this is harming this person or this person or this is doing this. No, the Word of God and the gospel of Jesus Christ is what I will preach until they don't let me preach it anymore. That's a great place for an amen, in case you're wondering. That is what we're facing. And you as a person, and we as a church, have got to make a choice now. Not when it happens. We need to decide now. Because when we're trying to discuss this when it's happening, that will be a horrible thing of horrible division and destroy the church. We need to decide now, where do we stand? Are we going to stand on the Word of God and the historical understanding of what the Bible teaches us about things? Or are we going to cave? But as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. Period. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for this day, God. And I want to say, God, thank you for the persecution and the suffering that I've had to endure in my life. God, I know it's not much compared to some of the other people, but it is the cross you have asked me to bear right now. And God, I thank you for that. And God, I thank you that you have given me the grace to stand in that challenge and that suffering. And God, as I see it in the next few years, as the persecution of the church begins to widen in the West and widen in America, that God, that you would give this church and the people of this church the grace to stand in the Word of God. God, don't let people think that they can stand on their own, but give them the grace and the power of the Holy Spirit to stand in their day of suffering, stand in their day of persecution. God, if they want to call us a bunch of radical zealots, they want to call us whatever they want to call us, I don't care. I want to be known as the people of God who stand on the word of God, who will not budge and will not move. As the song said today, I will not be shaken. God, if there's people in here right now that do not know you, that do not understand, they don't understand why anyone would put themselves in a situation where they would be in the place of suffering for some ancient book that may or may not be true, God, I pray that the Holy Spirit begins to soften their hearts and work on their hearts, that, God, they would learn to know that there is a God that loves them and cares for them, and he cares about what they think and they say and they do. And they would have a very real encounter with the man, Jesus Christ, who died for them. And God, let us stand firmly on the gospel of Jesus Christ. And there's no other name given among men under heaven by which men can be saved. Our president can't do it. Our government can't do it. God, the word Baptist can't do it. There is no other name under heaven amongst men by which men can be saved. We will lift up the name of Jesus no matter what. In Jesus' name, amen.